Attention. The movie guys love movies. Any comments about the opening of the Wizarding World of Harry Potter are purely for entertainment purposes.
What the?
State your name for the record.
Jin Erso.
Forgery of imperial documents. Possession of stolen property. Aggravated assault.
They have aggravated assault in space.
On your own.
Does that happen in space?
15.
It's what
reckless,
started us.
Aggressive and undisciplined.
This is a rebellion, isn't it?
And they have English accents because they're from space.
They're from space.
I rebel. I rebel.
You talk over the punchline?
Oh, sorry.
How dare you talk over your Star Wars training?
So now do you get it?
No, I'm calling BS because you had me. Really, I was really hooked with this Wizarding World of Harry Potter. I wanted to hear more about that.
That's the thing.
Oh.
Okay, so Universal works for years.
Yes.
We're bringing the
Harry Potter. To literally build a physical place.
Hogwarts appeal. We're building the Wizarding World of Harry
Potter.
That's made a dollar or two for them, right?
So, we've taken down a classic venue where Steve Martin has performed, the Blues Brothers.
Gibson Amphitheater. Leveled it. They put up Hogwarts. It's good to go. Disney says, hey, we got a new Star Wars movie coming up. When should we put out the trailer for that?
Ugh.
Same day.
Same day.
Same day as opening here. Oh,
no
man.
Professional courtesy
pulling
in this business?
Pulling the rug up. It was a move Grand Moff Tarkin would have been proud of. Truly. You may fire when ready.
I do like the fact that they all have British accents.
I thought you said
British
Grandma
accents.
Tarkin. Because
no,
my Grandma Tarkin was a real SOB.
No.
Oh. Grandmar.
Grand Moff.
Moff.
Moff. General.
The general with Tarkin. The gaunt face.
Peter
Remember?
Cushing.
Oh,
you
yes.
Know, you know he's evil because it's Peter Cushing.
That was my Grandma Tarkin. Grandma Tarkin's a real...
Did she look like Peter Cushing?
Well, in a later age, yeah.
Welcome to the Movie Showcast, everybody. Part of the vast and sprawling Movie Guys empire. You know, there are times when a critic truly risks something, and that is in the discovery and defense of the new. You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with rants, sketches, previews, characters, jokes, bits, banter, special guests, and more. You can expect that in the next hour plus as we broadcast from the Admiral's Club in the heart of Burbank Airport's flyover zone. They don't stop making movies, so we don't stop making comedy shows about movies, which means you can get a new show every week. Absolutely.
You know, Paul, I love to pick up the check, but right now I'm feeling...
Don't sweat not, Bart.
Yeah.
The show is free.
Oh, okay. Well, carry on then.
That goes for everybody. And we encourage you to follow on social media at The Movie Guys on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, which is also free.
Wow.
And get interactive. Basically, just search The Movie Guys on Bing, Google, or... Thank you. That's Yahoo.
You use it every week. What movie is that from?
Dr. Strangelove?
Indeed.
Thank you.
Good job.
I'm on to the lightning round.
So search us. We come right up. I'm your host for the hardest working comedy show on the airwaves, Paul Preston, here with Bart Caius.
Spalding, get your foot off the boat.
And Karen Volpe.
Claire, it's like Geppetto in here.
Adam is ill.
Ooh, topical and
yes,
recent.
From the boss, yeah. Adam is ill or lying about an illness in order to go to a redneck trucker double feature at the New Beverly Cinema. Greatest cinema in the world.
Who could blame
that's
him?
That's what's happening.
Joining us later in the show for our guest segment is someone who's been acting since she was a young girl and in that time has appeared on all of your favorite shows. Name one.
The X-Files.
Yes.
House.
Yes.
Law and Order.
Yes.
ER.
Yes. And before you continue,
oh, okay.
Also Crossing Jordan, Longmire, CSI,
that.
Cold Case, the list goes on and on.
That's where I've seen her. TV.
Yes. Yeah. Once and always.
You know, usually you see celebrities at the Albertsons.
At Albertsons or on the sidewalk.
But
this one was
TV.
On TV. Paul, oh, well done.
The legendary star of Anne of Green Gables and now featured in season 3 of Reign, the CW network show as Queen Catherine de Medici.
Yes, correct.
Thank you. Megan Follows will be
Yay!
Here later. So that's
Yay!
Also correct, Megan. Yes. I learned that today. Mm-hmm.
And as ever, we will bring you movie previews, as we do every week.
Good.
Prepping you for the big weekend at the Multiplex, and this week sees 3 new films, really something for everyone.
Mm.
As this we hinted at last week, we have Criminal, Barbershop, The Next Cut. This film that opens on tax day. This is if getting a buzz cut from the IRS isn't enough. And later in the show, The Jungle Book, one of the
Yay!
Most beloved stories about abandoned children ever to come to the big screen.
I can't help but notice there's this strange odor today. Man is forbidden!
Run, Mowgli!
Mowgli does run, I imagine, for the duration of the film.
Yeah, that is really intense.
Question.
Yes, sir.
As a point of movie jail.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I have not seen any Jungle Book at all.
Now, you know there have been five different five or more.
Jungle Bai or Jungle Boo.
Jungle Books.
Jungle Books. Jungle's Books. It's like Attorneys General. Sorry. Jungle's Books. Wow. Haven't seen any of them. And okay. Actually had the hardcover as a kid.
No, wait a minute. But the real one you have to see is
this
Disney.
One. Is this one?
Oh, Disney.
Well,
the original Disney
one.
Animated.
Oh, okay.
Disney animated.
Yeah, can you do that? So Disney's put out two or three of these?
They've done this.
Well,
101 Dalmatians. They did
I was just
going
to say, then they made a live action.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
That's true. Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. But I've not.
And
this
Cinderella.
Might...
They've done so many versions of Cinderella.
Yeah. The last one was quite good.
Really good.
Mm-hmm. I think this is the Jungle Book I'm going to see. Yeah.
This is the Jungle Book you're looking for?
This is the one I'm looking for.
I don't know, man. That's a great cartoon, the first one. It's so great. And it's hip and cool and.
Didn't they recently sanitize it? Wasn't it vaguely racist somehow? They got rid of Baloo doing some scatting
know.
Or shucking and jiving. Yeah, I'm getting nods from the audience. Yes.
Yeah, oh, we'll look into that later.
Industry Insider says our sensitivities have gotten so heightened that they went back and cut something out of the Jungle Book.
The Jungle Book?
Yes.
Not Song of the South. The Jungle Book.
Correct. Jungle Book? Thank you.
I think they just did away with Song of the South.
Yes. Yeah. Hollywood veteran has confirmed my suspicions.
All the way from the green room.
Yes. All the
well,
way.
She sent me a text.
all right. Well, listen, you should see both. Well, from what I've heard, man, there's 40 reviews out there already for the new one. Mm-hmm. All thumbs up. So it's like 100%.
You want to go to hell? Write a bad review about Jungle Book. Go ahead.
I dare you.
Tempt the gods.
Well, when I looked at IMDb, because you had hinted to me that there were a whole bunch of Jungle Book movies.
Jungle's Book.
Some of them, yeah. They're not going to be getting good reviews. It was like a Japanese anime one that was like weird.
Oh, wow.
Paul, I just had an amazing thought. Next week, Paul and I are going to watch Bill Murray golf, but he's going to be coming off of a great opening weekend with awesome reviews of Jungle Book. He's going to be super crazy.
When I do this, that means time out.
Yes,
you're going to go see Bill Murray golf?
Oh, yeah. You didn't know that?
No, I knew you were leaving town.
Well,
yeah,
you'll never see me again.
Murray Brothers charity golf tournament.
Is Joel going to be there?
Yeah.
Friend of the show?
Friend
Does
of the
know?
Show. Yeah, he's going to know when I get there.
Karen, everyone knows
know.
When you get there. When you get wherever you go,
Thank
everyone
First of
knows.
All, Bill Murray's security will be alerted.
And then his brother will hide because I'll know him. So he'll be in big trouble.
I predict big things for you in this golf weekend.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Oh, I want to go back to the quote I led at the top of the show with. There are times when a critic truly risks something, and that is in the discovery and defense of the new. You know what that's from?
No, I didn't even know that was a joke.
It's not really a joke. It's just a cool thing about criticism. It's from Ratatouille.
Ratatouille.
Because
great movie.
Pixar
great
is,
movie.
You know, some of the best filmmakers out there, and their scripts are just as great as their animation and their voice talent. They're just amazing. And that's from Anton Ego. It's like the bad guy. But eventually he reveals that little gem that, you know, it's actually a risk to get behind something that's new and exciting. And he says, the world is often unkind to new talent, new creations. The new needs friends. I thought that was cool.
I'd like to be a friend of the new.
Not nude. Nude.
Oh, I'm sorry,
and then
yes.
when Anton goes to, what is it called? The restaurant where
I like to think
Remy
I'm already
works.
A friend of the nude, Karen.
I'm so sure you are.
when Anton goes and he has the meal at the end, a Gusto's or whatever it was.
Where he makes Ratatouille.
It's the funniest moment of the movie when he eats the food. It's just amazing. Oh, Adam also, he couldn't be here because he's sick. Yep. Or is he at the New Beverly watching this?
They got the muscle. They own the law.
You're under arrest for the murder of Dwayne Howard.
They terrify his wife.
Take the deal and let's get the hell away from here.
He's a working man who's had enough.
A bitty dog.
A farm in the
You
back.
Know who this is. You call him and tell him I'm coming here.
So that's that truck driver movie?
Yeah, well, White Lion Fever, I think it's called.
Dear.
Something with Jan Michael Vincent just going against the bad guys in all 70s clothing and cars.
Is it from the 70s or is it supposed to look like a 70s
Here's
movie?
What it's teamed up with.
Henry Fonda's a truck and cop.
Now that's a 70s movie.
Luck, wouldn't have no luck at all.
He's got a stolen rig hauling seven shady ladies.
Leave me alone. I'm married.
Ain't nobody but married.
Pete's got the front door and the wireless convoy to hit the south and Smokey's out to shut him down. It's the Great Smoky Roadblock, Sunday right after Disney and Chips on NBC.
All those Smokies. Oh,
not only is an old trailer amazing. Great, but it's also great to find out what it was playing with. Disney and chips.
Was that Casey Kasem?
Yeah. It was.
That was Casey Kasem.
You used to do your NBC lineups every night.
So I grew up in Ohio, and trucker and trucker life and trucker talk, Smoking the Bandit, Convoy. As kids, we played that out in the front yard.
Yeah,
oh,
those
my
played
gosh.
Last month. The New Beverly is the greatest cinema in the world.
My brother had a trucking shirt, Keep On Trucking, and it had a truck on it. He would only take it off. he was little, and he would only take it off so my mom could wash it.
I didn't have a handle, though.
Oh.
No, well, I didn't. Yeah. I didn't.
Chubby Tough. I think that was my handle.
Were you on the CB?
Okay.
We had
so
a CB.
So we had CBs in the neighborhood.
Oh.
And we had next door neighbors had a CB, and they had a bass in their home, right? And they had that tall CB that looks like an old timey phone that you hold. And then their two cars were wired to CBs, and they would talk to each other like going to the grocery store, and it would interfere with our television reception. And so we would hear their conversations on our TV, because that's back when nobody had cable.
Trying to watch the Browns lose.
Exactly. Yeah. And now we hear John and Sharon actually having a conversation about picking up soup.
I remember a really specific CB radio moment. My dad and I were going to get ice cream, and we lived out in the middle of nowhere, so it took like 20 minutes each way to go to the nearest little store. And so on the drive, my dad would hold the CB radio up, and I'd sing into it. And so my mom was home listening to me sing Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. Aww. Until I screamed, and she thought we got an accident. But what happened was, the light hit the reflection in the window just right, and it looked like, in my mind, Darth Vader's hand was coming in the window.
Of course, of course.
Because Star Wars was really big then, and my mind was all captured by that. And it was the reflection of the radio and the red and the black, and I started screaming, thinking Darth Vader was going
to
get us.
In your car. Darth Vader was coming to get you in your car.
Yes.
No, but I have visions
I was really
of
little.
Karen driving through the neighborhood and everybody's TVs being interrupted by her Twinkle Twinkle Little Star as she goes by their homes.
It was awesome. I freaked out.
CB means, of course, Citizens Band.
Oh.
And
I don't believe that
today the Citizens Band is Twitter. So I ask you, on CB, was it as racist and negative as Twitter?
I also, as a young man, moved furniture as a summer job. And anyone who's looking for a summer job, if you have the opportunity to move furniture, don't. It is the worst thing
Why
you could
would
do.
I know? I don't want to do that. Friends ask me and I say no.
Exactly. I'm not going to do it in an afternoon, let alone for a career.
Yeah.
And so I've spent some time in trucks doing long hauls. And
the
answer to the question is...
Let's get on to our first film of the weekend.
Barbershop 2, Electric Boogaloo.
Actually, this is the third Barbershop movie, not the second.
Yeah. Oh, man. You mean I missed Electric Boogaloo installment?
No, that's because there was no Boogaloo installment of the franchise.
Oh, great. Something to look forward to then.
All right, well, you seem qualified to talk about it.
Is it because of my hair, Paul?
Let's tell the people hair, all they need to know about Barbershop, the next cut. Here we go.
For anyone who has felt that Spike Lee's Chi-Rac didn't address the issue of violence in Chicago strongly enough, there's Barbershop 3, the new batch.
It's been 10 years since the crew of Calvin's Barbershop shot the breeze while cutting box fades, and nothing has changed except the color of the president and the zigzag pattern you have to run in when going to the corner store now in Chicago.
The first and second Barbershop movies were little more than chronicles of a day in the life of. But Barbershop, the legend of Curly's Gold, promises to break new ground by examining a whole bunch of days in the life of.
The neighborhood has changed and the streets are turning mean, I think. And so the barbershop springs into action.
The barbershop is the pillar of the neighborhood. So we turn the shop into our safe space with free cuts and styling.
I'm sorry, Paul. Did I just hear the phrase safe space uttered at the barbershop? What's next, gluten-free hair weaves?
# barbershop saves the neighborhood is trending on Twitter.
Can I get a selfie with you?
What the white girls want, they lost?
Dear Lord, it's even worse than I thought. The barbershop is being invaded by white people. Oh, there goes in the neighborhood.
Before you can say, I'll take a kid and play, Ice Cube's character is now a father and worries that the crime his son is exposed to might turn his child into a thug or pimp or only able to express his dislike of authority in rhyme.
The entire original cast returns along with some new faces that you'd swear were in the previous movies.
Actually, some of the biggest stars of music industry appear in Barbershop, The Next Cut.
Baby, I'm born, how I've adored.
From The Simpsons?
Not that barbershop?
Referring to Ice Cube, Nicki Minaj, and Common, all of whom have starring roles in this third installment of the barbershop franchise. It started in 2002. Back when Ice Cube was still a music star, sort of.
That's right. This installment of Barbershop has its sass factor dialed up a notch or two with the addition of its newest cast member, Nicki Minaj's butt.
And if you want to be Beyonce featuring Jay-Z, boom, boom.
With all that ass, she ain't safe nowhere.
And the sequel again features the antics of Cedric the Entertainer, her there, continuing to shake the burden of having to live up to his surname.
This looks ambitious, carrying on the film franchise while addressing gang crimes in their neighborhood. Although, if they only focused on the shooting aspect and how serious that gets, they should have called this film Barbershop, Who's Gonna Shave Me?
Who's gonna shave me?
Oh,
Barbershop 3, The Secret of the Ooze, delivers exactly what we expect from not only sequels, but haircuts as well. Give me the same, but different.
There you go, that's Barbershop 3. The next cut. What's the second one called?
Back in Business?
Oh, I think so.
Yeah, back at it.
Cutting again.
Karen, we open the floor to you.
I'm trying to think of... if I've ever been in a barbershop, I don't know, women...
No, these things don't really exist, right? These places don't really exist.
Yes, that's why there's this movie.
Yeah.
It's like the 80s party in John Hughes movies. They never really happened.
Those didn't happen. Okay, you're right. These happen.
These still happen. I think that...
And the way they laugh in this trailer, I want to go there. They just cut jokes and laugh all day.
Yeah, I don't know how they're making any money.
They're not. They even said we're giving out free cuts to save the neighborhood.
I have a feeling that it's kind of like hanging out in a coffee shop, only it's not like you keep going there to get your haircut. You go there to visit your friends who work there, and you go there to get to hang out with your friends and on your way home from work and stuff. It's more of a social thing.
I haven't been to a barber in 12 years.
Ladies and gentlemen, he doesn't have a lot of hair, so it's hard for him to relate to
all this. I can get this at home.
I can grow that long, and you could have
that. You could grow this long.
Greg Nicotero look.
Oh, God. Do you have any idea what this would look like at any length at all? It would just be a disaster.
Well, I do want to say that we had a girl that was working on the show with us, and she was lovely, and we were doing the live show, and so we had to wear wigs and
this
stuff.
This is brilliant.
And, he puts on a wig because he was playing a rock star, and she just looked at him and stopped cold and said, "You look really great with hair."
She said,
"Is that what she said?"
No, she said, and I quote, "Thanks for letting me remember all this."
Yeah. She was complimenting you in a way.
She said, "Oh my God, you look so much better with hair."
Oh, okay.
And I said,
"She was young."
I said, "No, no, it gets better." And I said, "Well, thank you, Kristen." She's like, "No, no, I didn't mean that. I just meant younger."
Oh, no.
Oh. What could have been, ladies and gentlemen?
You do
what
look
could
great
have
with
been?
Hair.
It's true. Again,
we have an idea that he should be able to wear whatever hair he wants.
Casual hair. I should be able to just show up with hair that goes with the outfit.
Yeah.
Oh, I worked this Wizarding World of Harry Potter event.
Yeah.
Billy Bob Short showed up
in his hair.
Red carpet hair.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, red carpet hair.
And no one's calling BS on that because we all know he's doing it just because it goes well with the vest.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. It went well. It was white, sort of shaggy.
Kinda shaggy.
It went well with the army type jacket.
What? He had like a whole effect?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
It kind of looked, it was shaggy, kind of hipstery.
Billy Bob Thornton. Red carpet hair. I need some red carpet.
I need evening hair, active hair,
maybe
sporting hair. Well, this is the
movie
sporting
guy's hair.
Movie guy hair.
Yeah, this is sporting.
This is sporting.
Your head
hair.
Can breathe this way.
I can swim and jog and I don't have to worry about stuff.
Okay, back to the movie. I think I'm going to see this because I like the fact that they're taking the comedy and actually do. I mean, it's quite a risk, perhaps, to take the comedy and the having fun and to actually address a serious issue that's going on in Chicago.
Mm-hmm. I'll be curious to see how they address it.
Yeah,
I don't know who they're pointing the finger at. I don't know if they are pointing the finger. I want to know how the barbershop saves this neighborhood. Yeah. How does that happen? Yeah. It is a safe space. After
if they
all.
Don't, then we have. The final cut coming after this.
Did you burp or
safe space
pass
just
out?
Me,
what did you do?
I just safe space. Just get over your safe space.
It's kind of like going to the fire department. You can drop off your baby there. It's a safe space. Just drop your baby
Let's
off
get on to our next movie.
At the barbershop. What?
Let's get on to our next movie. It's The Jungle Book.
Electric Boogaloo.
Bart. The countdown to the live-action Black Cauldron continues as Disney presents its latest people-fied adaptation of an animated classic, The Jungle Book. Now, who would want to talk about this? Karen, perhaps?
Get down, get down, get down, get down, get down, get down.
And what actors all across Hollywood are hoping is a new trend. Animated characters are being replaced by real-life human beings in this reimagining, re-envisioning, remaking, re-improving version of The Jungle Book.
Say, are you the kind of moviegoer that likes to criticize and find some kind of fault with every movie you see? Well, move along, movie Scrooge. You are entering a snark-free movie zone because this is the preview for Disney's The Jungle Book starring Bill Murray, who voices Baloo the Bear. So, do your best, movie misanthrope. I dare you to find a single thing wrong with this sweet and enduring tale of a boy's passage into manhood, a journey of self-discovery with a myriad of jungle characters that help him learn about life and himself along the way. That's what I thought.
The Jungle Book is so classic that it was a classic long before Disney called everything they make a classic. I'm looking at you, Treasure Planet.
Ooh.
The original Jungle
Book. Call it out, Treasure Planet. That's right.
That's brave. The original Jungle Book was released in 1967, which explains the character of Eagle Knievel.
That's so stupid.
Shh. Enough out of you.
The animated classic The Jungle Book, with the last feature film Walt Disney had an actual hand in before his death in 1966. He closely reviewed the scripts and helped make it a family-friendly cartoon filled with jokes and songs.
By contrast, this new live-action version looks like a hyped-up, aggressive, danger-filled Disney. Like they took Walt out of his cryogenic freezer and rinsed him off with the blood of Arnold Schwarzenegger.
To show them how to throw the discos.
I never understand what he says.
It's pretty realistic. I'd buy it as Disney Nature's The Jungle Book.
Director Jon Favreau decided against making this film a musical like the original because it was hard to find talking animals that also sang. We're nothing if not about news here.
Everyone's so specialized these days.
Plus, there's not a lot of multidisciplinary wildlife. It's
no more triple threat animals out there.
Baloo is known for the most famous song, which I know we all know.
Oh, here it comes.
All right.
That might have been from his television show.
Might have been.
The voices that make up this ensemble of beloved Disney characters couldn't be better.
No, it couldn't.
Ah, Karen's pretty excited about this one. She couldn't sleep.
Can I introduce him?
Karen's been excited the whole show to reveal one particular cast member. Go ahead, Karen. I know you're primarily going to see this movie for...
Ben Kingsley!
Hmm? Wait, what?
Is there any better voice to bring off the cool authority of Mowgli's panther ally, Bagheera, than Kingsley, who first rose to prominence in the Royal National Theater production of Volpone?
You have a point, Karen.
But that's not the cast member you told me was involved in the bear sex dream you told me about?
Okay, also starring the movie is the voice of Giancarlo Esposito.
All right, stop messing around.
The Jungle Book also stars Bill Murray.
God damn it, Bill Murray!
And since he may not sing Baloo's famous song in the movie, at least he sang it on TV last week when he went on Jimmy Kimmel Live.
We have not rehearsed this. A 5, 6, 7, 8. They're called the bear necessities, the simple bear necessities.
Forget about your worries and your strife.
Just the greatest guy in the world, right? Bill Murray? What great casting is that?
And if you haven't seen this clip, he's wearing a great hat.
He's got
an amazing hat on when he's doing this.
Absolutely.
Got a whole outfit.
We're all going to see, and by all, I mean everybody that lives.
Everybody is going to see that.
So, as that clip demonstrated, this is the point I wanted to make earlier.
Yes.
How did we just now, think about voice casting Bill Murray? How has this not happened before? Has he done voice? Did he do Garfield? Is that
He did Garfield. He did Fantastic Mr. Fox.
Yeah.
Oh, is he? Oh, okay.
He did Osmosis Jones.
Alrighty.
But you didn't see that.
I didn't see any of those. I remember Garfield, and he took Garfield because he got the Coen brothers confused, right? He signed up based on...
But he did the sequel, so you can only say something.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, the check cleared on the first one, so of course he's doing the second one.
One thing I like about... Well, I like everything about Bill Murray, but a thing that I like very much about Bill Murray and this character is they come together with the idea that that Bill's been spouting even as far back as... Where is it? As the Razor's Edge. The idea that life is going to be... It's not... controllable, and it's more of how you look at life that makes it what it is, and you just have to live every moment with the people that you're with because that's the only moment you can control or have any say in. So if you're always looking to the future or the past, you can always be waiting for something to happen and be anxious about it or be regretting something maybe that you did in the past. So he has been doing poetry readings. He did a poetry reading on Kimmel. On Kimmel.
Yep, that same night. Because someone approached him about poetry.
It was Oprah.
In a magazine, yeah. And he had he had a page.
And he had
his favorites.
A couple of his favorites, and he read it. And it's really just about taking the exact moment you're in and living it. And it's really a brave thing to do, because you always want to plan for the future and what if something goes wrong. But that's what this character is all about, even the Bare Necessities song. You just need what you need to get by right now.
It is inspired casting.
Mm-hmm. That was a deep dive there.
To that deep dive.
I just love Bill Murray. But I just don't know what I'm going to do if anything ever happens to him. I'm probably going to have to stay home for a while.
That day will come. But there's just
not supposed to look for you immediately.
I look to the future. See, I messed up.
You're rooting for his death.
No.
Oh, dear Lord.
Not rooting, preparing. But still, let that go.
I was trying to figure out what. When we see him next week, I was trying to figure out. Again, thinking in the future. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to handle it. When I met Lyle Lovett for the first time, I just stood there like an idiot and smiled. And then he finally saw that and went, "Hi, I'm Lyle Lovett." And I went, "Hello." Yeah. And that was the end of it.
Thank you for the last name, because otherwise I'd have no idea which Lyle you are. Who's a tall, handsome
really
Texan
nice.
Guy with the big hair.
Yeah.
But you've moved on to that, so now you're
Yeah, now we're
with,
buddies. Yeah,
now you're buddies.
I've gotten past that.
Imagine if you were as good of friends with Bill Murray as you are with Lyle Lovett. Imagine that in your life. Don't look forward into the future. Just imagine it
now.
Imagine it happening now. I have nothing snarky to say about this movie.
Yay, that's amazing.
It was so hard to write jokes for this thing. Because I'm like, I want to go see this beautiful
film. Voice casting is going to be really amazing. There's lots of really cool people. Scarlett Johansson is in
it,
too.
Yeah, it did scare me off, too. Because sometimes you see, like, one of the early trailers didn't have them talking. And then the next trailer, they were talking. And you're like, I remember a movie came out called Dinosaur from Disney about 2000. And the first trailer, there was no talking. And then the next movie, they talked. And it kind of punched a hole in the magic that the first trailer set up. And so I was hoping the voice talent, it's just like everything just fits.
Jon Favreau, too, fantastic director, really creative.
What character does Scarlett voice?
The python.
A snake.
Yeah.
Because she can't say anything without slightly getting me aroused.
Well,
so I don't
it's
know
gonna
how
happen.
You do this in the, I mean,
because she's a sexy snake.
It's got the sexiest voice in the world, right? She's got one of the.
She had a fantastic
Bill
voice
Murray,
in that.
Then Scarlett Johansson, and voices are that are sexy. That's your order, right there.
Now, this is something I wanted to bring up because the great Gary Shandling, he passed away recently.
He's in this.
Yeah, he plays. I went and I looked it up. He plays a little porcupine named Icky, I-K-K-I, and it wasn't in the animated movie. It was originally in the book. And so Jon Favreau wanted him to do it, and he asked him to do it. And the neat thing is that Gary Shandling wasn't happy with what he did in the first recording, so he asked Jon Favreau if he could go back. And Favreau's like, "No, you can't make it any better. You did great." And he goes, "No, I know I can." And then Favreau goes, "Well, it's sort of locked as far as the animation. You're going to have to make everything move to the movement." He said, "I got it." Went back in and made it even better. And because he went and did that, he was able to see his parts before he passed away. Mm-hmm. That's kind
of
cool.
And a little shout out to Jimmy Corrine, our guest from a couple of weeks ago, who just had Favreau on his show, Improv Nerd. So go to
Feral
Audio, listen to Improv Nerd. He's got a good interview with and there's another Bill Murray story.
I got to check that out.
Rhett Reese on here who wrote Deadpool and talked about on Zombieland how you got to track Bill Murray down for your project. He has another similar story. Like, he's an enigma.
That's amazing.
So, but it's fun.
All right.
All right, well, for our final film, fans demanding a reunion of the JFK cast have partially gotten their wish with Criminal, which brings together Tommy Lee Jones and Gary Oldman to support Costner in the lead role. Bart, let's talk about it. Here we go. Criminal. 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 Yeah. After the untimely death of a young, handsome, agile CIA agent played by Ryan Reynolds, his memories, skills, and the secret to how Deadpool made that much money are implanted into the mind and body of an aging death row inmate with arthritis, a bad hip, and a penchant for napping. Maybe we made that last part up. But with the wide availability of Keanu Reeves, why would you choose some old guy in death row as the person into whom you implant this great resource of ability?
Because that death row inmate is Kevin Costner?
You make a good argument.
Thank you. And so they take the memories, skills, and abilities of a dead CIA agent and implant them into the death row inmate with anger issues.
What could possibly go right?
A whole bunch of stuff goes right if you're making an action movie where Kevin Costner kicks a whole bunch of ass. That's what goes right. So it's up to Gary Oldman to have Costner complete the CIA operative's mission.
Everybody getting this so far?
Yay, Bill Murray.
Hmm. a spy that can't remember anything about his life and has to fight both the good guys who control him and the bad guys who want him dead just to stay alive and win his freedom? Now, where have I seen this before?
Matt Damon.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Jan Stroop, Dutch program. He needed protection. Remember? You got him to the safe house. Where did you put him? That is all we need to know.
All right, sounds simple enough, right? I mean, I'm sure that's all he does in this movie. Costner remembers the stuff, and then he tells the appropriate authorities what they want to know, and then that is that. Or all that happens.
There's
okay,
that.
So maybe things don't go quite as smoothly as they planned.
It's a movie, isn't it?
The idea of transferring memories and wiping out other memories was given to the CIA by the same scientists who have mastered the art by wiping the memories of people in RoboCop, Total Recall, Selfless, Blade Runner, and more. This time they called the procedure Operation Let's Try Again.
Kevin Costner keeps his streak of probably watchable performances alive as Jericho Stewart, winner of the Name a Nicolas Cage Character Contest, narrowly beating out Quaker Wells, the actual name of the character played in Criminal by Gary Oldman.
Ryan Reynolds' shape-shifting career continues. First, it was the movie Selfless, where Ben Kingsley's character's personality was implanted into the body of Ryan Reynolds' character. Mm-hmm. Next, it was Deadpool, where Ryan Reynolds' body is transformed into a superhero and his face is hidden by a mask. Now, we have Criminal, which is another movie where Ryan Reynolds' character's personality is put into someone else's body. Why do movies keep on hiding Ryan Reynolds from me? I'm sorry, but am I missing something? Between his personality and his face, isn't his face the more charming of those two?
The film, shame on you. The film also stars Jerry Lewis's favorite actress.
Nice lady, Wonder Woman, who's Gal Gadot.
Gal Gadot!
Ryan plays Bill Pope, Gal plays Jill Pope. Bill and Jill Pope, the Popes.
So how do you justify having a 60-something Kevin Costner alongside a 30-something leading lady? Well, you implant the memories of her real husband into Costner. Way to go, Hollywood!
Wow.
Hashtag
wow.
National Equal Pay Day.
Brilliant.
The trailer does that awesome thing where a dude comes out of nowhere at the end of the movie. I love this, by the
yes.
way. He comes out of nowhere at the end of the trailer, a guy you've never heard before, and he says the name of the movie. He's not guiding you through the whole film. He just kind of shows up at the end and says, here's the name of the movie. I think we all remember when a film you may not remember called Ouija did this.
Ouija.
That guy is back with Criminal.
Criminal.
Like, who is that
really?
Guy? He just shows up at the end. To miss this film would be
Criminal.
Who does Kevin Costner play in this movie?
He plays the
Criminal.
You can even go outside of this movie and play with that guy's drop.
I don't like the way they've handled the characters of Batman, Superman in the latest movie.
That bad, huh?
Not just bad, Paul. It's
Criminal.
Yeah, which will Jericho Apollo Landmass defeat Alabaster Praxis and the Agents of Ether Necktie? Find out this weekend.
Yay! Can't imagine why you had a hard time with that sentence, Paul.
That sentence is insanity.
The word I screwed up.
What?
The word I screwed up. I recorded that line twice for those of you who don't know. We're not live.
That's a crazy
The word
line.
I screwed up was Will, though, in all
Oh, not Alabaster Praxis?
No.
Oh.
Ryan
yeah.
Reynolds is not easy to say.
Ryan Reynolds. It's a tongue twister.
It is, Ryan Reynolds.
I do agree with you, though. I never thought of that before. Ryan Reynolds is absolutely 100% charming, looking, and sounding, and being.
Sexiest man alive.
But there's something about covering up his face.
They keep hiding him.
Why do you do that?
They put him in Ben Kingsley's body. They put him in a suit. They put him in Kevin Costner's body.
To hide Ryan Reynolds' face is just
criminal.
I had to do one more.
I've always thought he looked a little like a Berenstain Bear, though.
Oh, my word.
Or is that criminal? Is that criminal to say?
Is it
criminal? He's got a little...
Like a Berenstain Bear.
He's smiley. He's got a big smiley face,
you know what?
Maybe.
Listeners at home are going to look this up, and they're going to go, you know, that Bart's got a point.
That Bart's got a point,
got a point.
All right.
And he's not credited in the trailer. When they do they'll flash names on the screen during the trailer. Kevin Costner or Gal Gadot.
Yeah, I didn't know he was in this.
They don't put his name up.
Yeah,
and he's not on the wiki page.
He's doing like an uncredited type of thing. Yeah, like Robin Williams used to do. I was telling Bart, you know, watch Dead Again or The Adventures of Baron Munchausen. You'll see Robin Williams pop up uncredited, though.
And something else happens during this trailer that made me lose a little bit of hope, because I did not see 3 Days to Kill. Paul, you saw that.
Yeah,
Kevin Costner pulls it off, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Tough guy beating up people.
He's great at
great.
That. Since The Bodyguard, he's been great.
Yeah,
at
he's
that.
Really great at that.
So I was like, oh, I'm kind of in for this. It is a total Bourne Identity kind of ripoff slash selfless.
It looks like a Luc Besson movie, but yeah. It's not set in France, so it is not a Luc Besson movie.
And then halfway through the trailer, the music score changes, and it turns all lovey-dovey, and he's got this relationship that I got to worry about now with the wife and the daughter. I'm like, I don't want to. Just start shooting people.
Paul and I were talking about this the other day. This has nothing to do with this movie, but it has to do with you, Bart.
Then I'm all ears.
We need to get a drop where whenever we talk about Tom Cruise, it starts playing that song by...
All they do is win, 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 win.
Gonna win, win, win. Because that just is what you want. You want your lead character to win, win, win. Yeah.
I don't ever want to worry about whether or not he's not going to win.
Right.
Whether or not he's going to save the day.
Well, the good news is, you know Ryan Reynolds dead at the beginning.
Yeah.
So you don't have to worry about him. He's going to be dead, and it'll be, well, but and we'll see what happens.
And then we'll see what
happens. Can they get him out of Kevin Costner? Or did they have to eliminate Kevin Costner entirely from Kevin Costner?
No, he's gonna fall in love with the wife, and then that's what's going to happen.
It's going to be like Ghost.
Yeah,
he's
exactly.
going to make out with Whoopi Goldberg.
Ugh.
But here's the deal.
Today's Whoopi Goldberg or Ghost Whoopi Goldberg? Because, well, there's not much.
You said that Ryan Reynolds, Ben Kingsley, went his memories in Selfless went into Ryan Reynolds' head. Now Ryan Reynolds is going into Kevin Costner. So it's on Costner to hand it off in some future movie, right?
Yes. And there's another movie where this happened, but we got to see Ryan Reynolds. It was with Jason Bateman. What was it? Were they
the Change-Up?
Oh, The Change-Up.
That was a really good movie.
Yeah.
It's when they pee into a fountain.
They cross streams. Don't cross the streams,
don't
Ray.
Cross the streams. Yeah,
you saw that on TBS probably.
It was
right?
It's part of the TBS report. But yeah, that was actually a pretty good movie. But he does a lot of like shape-shifting Freaky Friday movies.
That's true.
He's going to remake Inner Space.
And then he does R.I.P.D. Oh. I just saying.
Oh, that's right.
That's good.
Okay, that's enough new movies. Let's talk with our guest, Megan Follows, who herself has been in plenty of movies, and we'll get to the bottom of all of them and do that right after 10 seconds of break. So we'll be back in just about 10.
Megan, how many people are playing the piano in that song?
I'm going to say one.
Yeah, but it sounds like a lot more, right? It can't be just two hands making all that.
Yeah, it goes on, doesn't it? I never played this song.
She rocks out. It's one of the girls from my group, the Boubet Sisters. That's Leah Finkelstein playing.
Oh, yes. Nice. Mm-hmm. And all her fingers.
And all her fingers. The Finkelstein fingers.
And her her band of ten.
Yes.
Fingersteins.
That's
the Fingersteins. Patent pending.
Oh, dear.
Leah.
Our guest is among us, as you may be able to tell, who started acting at a very young age and continues to work steadily today.
Yeah.
She appeared.
Yeah. Good job, you.
Woo. She appeared as Anne in Anne of Green Gables. And I know we mentioned a bunch of other TV shows where she appeared earlier. Here's more. Brothers and Sisters, Lie to Me, CSI Miami, The Division, Family Law, countless more. Today she can be seen as Queen Catherine on the CW's Reign, which returns Monday,
April
25th. Now that will be its spring launch.
We did half of the season three, and the winter finale actually was an episode that I directed.
Oh great! Yes. Good for you.
I was
going
to bring that up. It's Megan Follows. I should say.
Megan, that is awesome. Good for you.
Thank you.
That's
cool.
I have a slightly personal question about that.
He jumps right in.
Then we're going to get back to your list of TV credits because there was one missing that I'm very curious about.
Okay.
But when you get to direct. And this, you don't have to tell me the amount, but if you want to, you can.
Okay.
Do you get two paychecks?
Yes, you do.
Sweet.
Hey, nice. Yeah. You know, I'm glad to hear that on the Woman Equality Day.
You get a fee for the two services, right?
Yes, you do.
Wonderful.
If you're doing them both, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay.
I saw an interview with you on a Canadian television show. I assume it was Canadian.
They're awfully polite to each other, so I'm assuming it was.
But and he showed a clip of when you were a young kid being interviewed, talking about how you wanted to direct.
Oh, yeah.
And so I looked for where you directed, and it just happened this year. I mean, you've directed stage, but for film and TV, it just happened.
It just happened.
So good on you.
Thank you. Yeah, it was a long time making that dream happen.
Now, this was for Reign, right?
It was.
And you, anybody give any trouble? Anybody give you a hard time on the set? Or they all, you know. Oh.
Not to my face.
Queen Catherine's directing now.
Not to my face. That's the nice thing when you're actually on the show, they got to hide that.
There you go. Yeah.
And what's the draw? everyone says, well, what I really want to do is direct. I've been on movie sets and around. It seems like a lot of work.
It is.
I'd rather just stand around and act.
But see that,
not everybody does want to do it. And, yeah. And there's probably good reason for that. But I did want to do it. And I want to do more.
What's it like to want to direct? So how you were on this third season before you were able to direct it. Do you end up just having a vision for the show that you think needs to be brought? Or do you think I can carry the vision that's being portrayed already? How does that work? I can see somebody who says, I have a vision for a movie and I want to be a director, but here's three seasons of a TV show. Don't screw it up.
Yeah, you almost have to follow and stay in the lines.
Yeah, right? You do. And so the second one is very true. You have to be able to deliver and perhaps in the best way, build upon the vision that's already established. And so that's the great thing when you're in a show, and particularly in our show, and when you're living in a castle, you just know that world so well. So it was an absolute delight for me because I know those sets. I've done despicable things in most of those sets as my character.
Talk
as my
slowly.
Character.
Bart's like, I'm taking notes.
And it's kind of a delicious world to play in. So it was a treat.
With that, give the novice viewers summation of what to expect should they go, and I'll tell them where to go. Hulu, right? You can go to Hulu and watch all the seasons, pretty
much. You can. I think it's on Netflix now as well. It's on iTunes, and it's on Hulu. It's coming back on the air.
April 25th.
Fourth season?
No.
But it was just renewed.
And we're going to be starting our fourth season in June. So what is it about? Was that what you asked?
Yeah, you know,
is it actually?
What the hell is it about?
Is it inspired by history, or does it relive history? Does it reimagine?
I would say it's yes.
Okay.
Yes, and yes.
Oh, good. Okay.
Yeah, a lot of yeses. It's a historical fantasy. We are dealing with some real characters. Primarily Mary, Queen of Scots. We've got Queen Elizabeth, Catherine de Medici, who I'm playing. So there's the players in the court, and then other ones that we bring in. There are a lot of factual characters and events, and then of course it's really sort of a delicious kind of soap and drama, so we get to just kind of make up all kinds of crazy things in the castle.
But it's more funny than anything, right? Because I honestly haven't seen an episode. saw some really great
clips
of
clips
your work.
But some of the clips are, you're kind of
snarky. Hilarious. Is that its undertone, or is that its overtone?
No, that would be its undertone, and that's really... that is sort of my note more. I get to do everything, though, and that's why she's an incredible character to play. I feel so lucky that really to be playing this, not only this queen, this powerful woman, who's also very at times dark, and her actions are at times very questionable. Not to her. She's feels completely justified in her and the tyrannical things that she does at times, which makes it so.
So does Bart. Don't worry about
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
He does the same thing.
It all makes sense to me.
Yeah. But it's been fun because I've always looked for a way to find some humor in things. I think that and they like to write that for me, so I get to play in that world too.
Yeah, it's like Mad Men is not a comedy, but Roger's pretty funny.
But Roger's really funny.
So the best dramas have that. Yeah. You know, Sopranos had a sense of humor.
Well, then I must have had a very skewed impression because I went online and saw just a composite of all the zingers.
My zingers.
I'm like, oh, it's hilarious.
They give me a lot of zingers, so yeah. I do. I get to do that, and I also get to weep over things as well. I get to, you know, stand around and let people's heads get cut off, and then...
Oh, fantastic.
Well, there was a scene where your head's about to get cut off, and you're reading a menu, and you're like, my daughter can't have prawns. So I'm guessing you didn't get lopped off.
No,
right?
I was practicing in case my husband was going to have my head removed.
Right, so because he was doing it with other, you know, people's heads, right?
Yeah.
So you have to be ready for
that. You wanted to get fitted for your
I wanted to look good when and if it was going to happen.
The scene that I particularly enjoyed was the one where I don't want to die a syphilitic... mad woman, tell him I was helping poor children and they were starving and like it's hilarious.
Yeah.
So you have to think of what's going to come after you.
Well, you have to understand why I thought it was a hilarious show. I guess
no,
that's
I'm glad.
Not...
There is that element as well. There's
good.
Now, Paul, you did not know that I was going to do this, but we have a question from Ursula in New Jersey.
From a listener.
A woman I work with today found out you're going to be on, and she is a friend who loves you. But she doesn't know where you live, so we're all safe. Okay. And
but I am
she...
locked in a garage. Right.
Wait, you
Let's
can't get out.
Let's bring her out. She's here.
We flew her in from Jersey. No, but she actually had a question because we were just wondering, you know, what we could ask you. And so she really wanted to ask a real question. It's a good question. She just said if she had a chance to ask you a question, she'd want to know if the interpretation you're doing of Catherine was influenced by any other people you've seen play the part, or did you do it without watching any other actresses and just do it yourself without them in mind?
I did not see anybody else play the part. So I read some biographies on Catherine, and I knew a bit about her historically. Mm-hmm. And then really it was just me.
So it's coming out of your imagination.
Yeah.
Good.
Are there
for
a
you.
Lot of other performances yeah. of this character out there?
I don't know that there are. I don't mm-hmm. feel like she is one that actually there is a lot. I mean, it's nothing like Elizabeth.
And she's a contemporary of Elizabeth?
Yes. Well, she was the mother of Francis II, who was married to Mary, Queen of Scots. So Mary, Queen of Scots, grew up actually in the French court. Mm-hmm. And she was, as a little girl, she was taken out of Scotland and she was raised in France with Catherine de Medici and her family and her many children, because Catherine had gave birth to nine children, seven what? Survived.
God.
Well, that's a pretty good haul back
that's
then.
Back what? Then it was a lot, and she didn't have them for a while. So her story is actually fantastic, Catherine's. It's very dark and very. What's so fascinating to me about her is that she didn't come with a title, because she came from a very wealthy merchant family in Italy, and that so their power was in, and they had a lot of money. And they were very connected to Rome, but she wasn't a royal.
There's no royal blood then.
There was no royal blood. So her neck was often on the chopping block at times, and then until she could guarantee heirs to France.
No wonder she just started popping out babies. Yeah.
Well, she did, and it took 10 years because she too was married at 14 to her husband. And he didn't want to touch her.
Well, that's surprising, actually. Usually it's the opposite problem.
But no royal blood also explains the straight teeth and the normal-sized ears.
Well, yeah, except for they weren't all... A lot of her children were very ill.
Oh, no.
Yeah, and she actually outlived three of her sons. She was queen regent because her sons were put on the throne when they were very young. One, the Francis, who died 6 months after he, or 8 months after he was became king, was only 14 when he married Mary, Queen of Scots. And he was very ill. So she was very strategic. She was very smart, Catherine. And it was really, it's interesting because she was incredibly smart in a time for women. Mm-hmm. This is a comedy show, right? So
I know, that's all right. Everybody's
like.
This is where we always get deep. Don't sweat.
No, that's
get deep about why I love Catherine.
Ursula, thank you for your question, by the way. Thank you very much.
We are first and foremost journalists.
Yes, we are definitely journalists.
As you can tell.
Then.
But she did. She outlived three of her children who she was queen regent.
You know what, though? I mean, Elizabeth had to be smart, too. She never married. You have to think of that stuff.
That's why Elizabeth didn't marry, actually. And that's why Mary Stuart, who did have a claim to the throne. In fact, Mary Stuart's son, James, became the king of England after Elizabeth died because she had no heirs.
She had no heirs.
But you were going to give away a lot.
Yep. And especially as a woman to finally have power, the minute you marry, you lose it.
That is
correct. Shocking.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, I always go check out movies and TV shows to find out how true the things are on the shows. Like, as soon as I saw Braveheart, I'm like, did the king really throw his son's gay lover out the window?
People,
I mean, what? He had him killed, I guess. I don't know if the...
But that's what art and theater and music and everything, it helps to do that, because if you see Hamilton, they say, I saw an article where Google, during the times that Hamilton has intermission and after it's over, people are Googling to find out how much of that is real. Because they go, wait, this guy really did all these things? And they start to learn about Hamilton. Kind of interesting.
How rabid is your fan base?
It's pretty. I mean, it's it's getting more rabid by the second. Even being here, I can feel it. It's happening.
Oh, you'll get the movie guys bump.
Oh, yeah, the bump.
Oh,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, that's why I'm here.
Big
I want
bump
the bump.
Back season 5.
I want the bump.
Not to sideline or sidetrack things, but
go for it. Yes.
Oh, we go on a tangent.
Yeah.
Hard to believe.
Born and raised in Canada.
Canada.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So just to kind of steer the conversation into actual movies, you were in one of my, which I didn't realize was my
Bart
favorite until
I
discovered
this. Bart wants to talk
about his favorite movie. You were in a movie called Hockey Night, and you were a May I ask you how old you were when you did that movie?
I was I 15? I think I was
15.
Yeah.
And cool. I saw this movie once. Once. And it has burned itself into my brain. Uh-huh. And it was this movie about a young girl. Would you care to brief us on this?
She was the only girl on an all-boys hockey team.
But
so
she ended up in this town.
Kathy Yarrow was the character's name.
I'm sorry?
Kathy Yarrow.
Kathy Yarrow.
And what was the town?
Was it Huntsville? Where were we? Some little town and with a lot of trees in the north.
Karen, I'm gonna thread you into this conversation.
Uh-oh.
Co-star on Hockey Night, Rick Moranis.
Yes, Rick Moranis was the coach.
Oh, Karen is equally in love with this movie.
Yeah.
So
fantastic.
I saw this movie once, and I have never ever forgotten that movie.
Well, I'm gonna watch it now.
And when I discovered you were gonna be on the show, and then realized you were Catherine Yarrow.
Yeah.
I actually watched it at work again today.
Did you really?
Yeah, because it's on YouTube. The whole thing's on YouTube. And all these memories came flooding back. It was on Nickelodeon when I was a child.
How many memories came flooding back?
They were all good.
All
well,
good
mostly
memories.
Of your horny friend in that. That friend of yours was, that character of your friend was
funny.
That's really, yeah, she was very funny, but she was trying to be the hip friend and show you the ropes, and she failed.
Criminal.
It
Sorry,
was.
You said memories coming back. Reminded me of that movie.
But for me, it was this weird place, Canada. Because I was born and raised in Ohio. Nickelodeon was our first window into the North. I mean,
Canada's great, though.
Right?
They have the best comedians, the best writers, best culture.
Absolutely.
Canada's awesome.
It
looked
best
a lot
bacon.
Like America, but there was something off about it, the way they talked and the way they interacted and the things that
they're
were important.
They're actually nice.
Yeah. Well, again, born and raised in Cleveland. So the other question I have for you, now that that was just me strolling down memory lane. Okay. Thank you for being next to me while that happened. That
You're
was
welcome.
Amazing.
Okay.
Paul read off a tremendous list of television credits. One was not mentioned, and I'm curious.
Uh-oh.
Were you ever on Degrassi Junior High?
No.
I know you'd think so,
you
right?
You would think. This is what I was thinking.
How did that happen?
I was never on Degrassi.
Did you ever audition?
No.
Oh, that's why she wasn't.
It wasn't the thing that every
that's the
kid,
only reason.
But it wasn't the thing that every child actor in Canada did or went through.
Not this one.
Okay,
You gotta have you gotta have something you can say. No,
you have to say no to something.
You gotta say something.
Well, they're bringing it back, so there might be
there
an
you
opportunity
go.
For it.
Right.
Yeah, there's like the fourth installment of this.
It could be like a mean teacher at Degrassi. Or?
Yeah.
How about Switchback?
or the hot senior high school girl that comes in from another town. We're not too sure.
And she plays hockey.
Yeah, she plays hockey.
No, there was a TV show at 10 o'clock on Sundays that I absolutely watched, like church, because I didn't go to church, and it was called Switchback.
No, you were too busy on the CB. Or
I was on the CB, hanging
singing
out.
On the CB.
Singing on the CB.
Fending off Darth Vader's.
Yeah. There was a guy named Sean Thompson, and he had a TV show, it was a talk show called Switchback, and it was out of Toronto, and I loved it. And he used to take a Ken doll and put him in a Kentucky Fried Chicken barrel and put him over the falls.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. I thought
that's what he did?
He was the greatest.
That's what you were watching.
I was watching that.
Well, that was Canada, right?
Yeah.
Ryan Reynolds.
So it depends on which falls.
We was Canadian side.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Ryan Reynolds, another good Canadian, right?
Yeah.
Rick Moranis, Dan Aykroyd.
If you could have, I put this to the
John
table.
Candy.
Someone in your head.
In your
like
head.
In this, like in this movie, Criminal, where Ryan Reynolds gets in Kevin Costner's head. Who would you want?
Bill Murray.
Well, yeah, there you go.
Who would I want in my head? Well, Tom Cruise.
That's right.
Yeah, they're done.
Done.
I think somebody wanted the voice of Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah,
that's true. I think she's right.
Let's be honest
she's
about
right.
that.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of which,
I want her in my pants, not my head.
Yeah. Well,
what was this
she's
got
to start somewhere.
She is playing
and
a snake.
There.
Yes.
Yes.
What about this cutting of Jungle Book? I didn't know anything about this. Jungle Book was cut because of some potentially offensive material?
Cut from.
Well, no, it was re-edited.
It was re-edited, and parts of it were.
Well,
cut
the other thing
out.
I was going to—I mean, it's pretty terrifying when you see the trailer. It's interesting. I mean, you do go from like the memories of the animated one, which is sort of Mowgli, and dun, 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 you know. So now this was like,
yeah, that thing's
like
right
terrifying.
In your face.
Oh, ferocious, yeah.
You know, it is like. I think the kids are going to need a little extra cuddling when they come home from watching Jungle Book. I don't know.
No, honestly, though, Paul, you're referring to my comment about how they had to re-edit. When they re-released the original animated 1966 animated version,
right.
There was a song, and I don't, well, obviously,
oh, I'm sure.
That was either cut out or edited because it was vaguely racist for today's modern sensitivities.
Yeah, I still get shocked when I watch Holiday Inn and they're all in blackface. Yeah, it's this lovely Bing Crosby, Fred Astaire movie. Then suddenly they're all in blackface singing some tune about how plantations were to blame.
Not good.
Yeah, but that Jungle Book will win the box office, right?
Well, it does have stiff competition with that Barbershop movie.
Yeah, those were all hits.
I was hard to say.
It wasn't a Tyler
giggling.
Perry Barbershop, though.
Oh, no?
Tyler Perry Barbershop would have been like box office gold.
Yeah.
So with this, I want to go back to this. The Rain fan base, because I looked at the Facebook page and there's people like Catherine de Medici rocks. She steals every scene she's in. So you show up at Comic-Con. What sort of experience was that?
We were still pretty new when we showed up at Comic-Con, and it was fantastic to feel the support of the show. It was the first time I'd ever been to an event like that.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a kind of
and that's the biggest. So they thrust you right in.
It is, and it's actually amazing that it's really a gentle spirit. I mean, it's a lot of adults dressed up in make-believe costumes. And I mean, what we do for a living, but people who are really kind of want to be out there and celebrate. So I think there will be more of that as Rain, as the fan base for Rain grows. But I do feel incredibly lucky. And I am new to, the Twitter and the Instagram world. I'm new to this thing,
It's high-techery.
You might end up being a Halloween costume.
Yeah. I know, yeah.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah, I was thinking actually I should, for one Halloween, put my own costume, do like half with a crown and then half with a red braid and go sort of like half Anne on this side and half Catherine.
You would create all sorts of craziness down at the Hollywood Carnival, yeah.
But you mentioned something that I noticed when I went to, I haven't been to many cons. Mm. That's what they call them.
They call them the cons.
Paul took me to what was the con?
WonderCon.
Yeah. Several years ago before it became super, super huge, right? It's like, it's blown up since
It's blown
then.
Up. It's still not as big as San Diego, but they moved it to L.A., and so more freaks showed up.
So
because it was close.
You mentioned
in Anaheim, it was just far enough away. But now the
freaks it's not in Anaheim anymore.
No, they moved to LA
it's in
this
LA.
Year.
So you had mentioned something about this warm, welcoming feeling, this peaceful. I felt like the toughest guy in that room, and it was really nice because no one had any attitude. There was no aggression. Yeah. Usually, when you get into a crowd of that many people. If you go to a hockey game or a basketball game or, God forbid, a boxing match, I mean, it's anything can break out at any moment, and you're kind of keeping your head on a swivel. At these places, it's just everybody's friend. It's
That's
the greatest
because everybody's
thing
there to participate, like you were saying, to dress up and have fun and very accepting of other people who want to be playful. It's great.
Go as sexy Catherine Medici.
That's fun.
Medici?
De Medici.
It's Italian. Are you Italian at all?
No.
That's cool.
I just went between action and cut. With a little French thrown in there. Yeah.
All right.
So let's go back to the beginning. So Anne of Green Gables.
Let's go back to
the
beginning.
Hockey night.
My father and my mother.
It's 93. There's 93 credits. I mean, we could talk all day. But I think of Anne of Green Gables as putting you on the map, but it wasn't far from your first job.
Yeah.
Yeah, they said something in IMDb about you playing on doing a gesture on a bus. Something from that commercial?
The first thing I did was a commercial for Bell Canada, and we were supposed to be kids out of the back of the bus, kind of like, making faces and everything, and my grandfather had taught me a gesture. And I was doing something and making, and I was told that was a little too rude. I wasn't supposed to. I wasn't at least given the finger, But,
good for you. And that was just you improvising?
Yeah.
Excellent work. Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you.
I was in a Canada Bell commercial.
You
I sold
were.
A cell
you
phone
sold
to a monkey.
A cell phone to a monkey.
That's that Canadian
you
sense
guys
of humor
have
there.
Yeah.
Was it Canadian Bell? It was one of those.
Paul, that wasn't a monkey. That was
just
Canadian.
Well, I remember specifically I was told I'm going to have a national commercial, but that nation was Canada. So I made some money. I didn't make a ton
of
money.
You didn't make a lot of money.
Didn't make quite the money I thought I was going to make, but it was still pretty cool. But then, of course, something that stands out, and I highlighted it right away, Facts of Life.
Joel Polnicek's cousin?
I was.
I love that.
Whoa, you really researched.
I loved the Facts of Life.
I know you loved it. It's true.
Multiple episodes?
No, I think it was just one. Mm. They were going to maybe at one point do a spin-off, and that didn't happen.
Oh, that's cool.
But I was Joe's cousin in New York. I worked in a garage. Well, I was a tomboy.
Of course.
So you're always playing somebody with a little bit of an edge.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Anne wasn't a wilting flower.
No.
So that's cool. And the kid on the bus, clearly.
Clearly. Yeah.
So really, you're going to probably kick our asses by the end of the show.
I've locked you all into the garage.
Hang on a second.
Come from an acting family.
I do.
Your mother and father are both established actors in Canada, stage, right?
Yes. And
So was America, was Hollywood the goal? Because you have a bunch of Canadian awards. I don't know what they're called. Junos or
they're
whatever.
Called Geminis.
Geminis or Juno. Juno's the
they
Canadian
keep changing
music.
It now.
Yeah.
So,
do they?
Yeah.
So growing up as an actress, actor, I don't know what the politically correct term
what
for what you
do.
What
they call them in Canada.
Yeah.
What do they call actors and actresses?
Well, don't they all call everyone
call them
actors
igloos
now?
And igluises.
They call them Tim Hortons.
Polar bears.
Beaver tails.
Beaver tails.
Was Being that the goal? Was it the dream to come to Hollywood, to New York? Was it?
The goal was to keep working was always the goal. And so sometimes I think in our, you know, if you can go to the States and you can get recognized and get work there, it can always help you get more work at home. And that's just was.
So that really wasn't the objective.
No, it wasn't the objective. I mean, for me, the objective was doing really good work or playing great characters.
Well,
and
you're
I,
one of those actors.
Oh, God.
Pride in work.
Yeah.
Passion about your job.
See, that's the thing, Bart, that you'll understand eventually. We want to keep working.
Oh.
Like, we're the one profession where we want to keep working. Everyone else is like, I can't
retire.
Wait till I retire. But, you know, I got nine more years of this crap.
If I can come to Hollywood and give birth to an alien on The X-Files,
you can do
know
anything.
If that was the end game. To, you know, that was my
was that
big moment.
Here when they were shooting here?
That was here. Yeah, I didn't
that's
do that
hilarious.
In
Oh, you did it here.
I did
girl.
That here.
Now,
I
that's
that
more of
right
an accomplishment.
Here in Los Angeles.
Good for
I
you.
Gave birth to an alien.
And now you live you. Here, but you shoot Rain in Toronto.
I
you
do.
Not?
Yeah. Funny. And But I grew up in Toronto. So yes. It's,
the great T.O. That's a great town.
Have you been to the Second City when it was still at the Fire Hall?
I have. And in fact, amazing. Actually, there's a very funny thing which I just retweeted, which was who said it first, Drake or Anne of Green Gables? There was
funny. That's great.
Drake, like the rapper Drake.
Yeah, because he's from Toronto. Yeah,
oh, that's so funny.
Because his new album is called The 416.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Did you know, did you ever meet Rob Ford?
Paul's just geeking out
now. Said 416, I thought Toronto. That's what I first thought of that guy.
Yeah, no, I didn't. And he is now passed.
I know. Yep. He just left us.
He did.
I brought the show down.
Yeah, I was saying that's all right. No,
there.
That's okay.
Well, no, okay. Let's get back to more charming tales. Silver Bullet.
there you go.
Based on a Stephen King novel I read a long time ago and movie I saw a long time ago. And how old were you in that?
I think I was 16.
Wow.
So what happens with no big deal to get in a big horror movie, or is it like we wigged out a little bit?
No, it was great. I mean, it was actually one of the funnier auditions. You know, it was like Dino De Laurentiis. It was his studios that were going to be in North Carolina, and I was meeting him here in L.A. And the car, the rent-a-wreck car, broke down on the way to meeting Dino De Laurentiis. I think it was at the Sunset. The hotel in Beverly Hills on Sunset, the Beverly Hills Hotel.
Okay. Oh, there you go.
There you go. That would be the hotel in Sunset. That would do it.
There's not a lot on Sunset right there. And you know what that means, though, also, if your car breaks down, that's a lot of walking.
It is a lot of
walking.
That's
a big distance.
You know, I just sort of got in there, and my mom was, like, stuck with the car. And basically, you know, it was like, you know, he took a look at me, he grabbed my face, and was like, well, put it in butt. Yeah, that'll do.
Oh my word!
He inspected you.
Oh
he
my
inspected
gosh.
Me. So I he had to. It had to be the final. So I guess I must have auditioned somewhere earlier, but you had to get the nod from Dino. So
that was literally the extent of it.
That's my memory in the room.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
Yeah,
who was also dead.
Yeah.
So
this is such
that.
A lovely conversation.
Wow. Remember dead people we talk about? Richard Farnsworth. Okay. So.
Yeah. Thanks.
You work with him. That's pretty cool,
have
right?
worked with people that are still alive and well.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, yeah, name two. Rick Moranis. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm changing gears for a second here because I hang on to stuff. Yes. Behind the set here in our garage studio, in our garudio, is a garage. So stuff is back there, including my extensive career of Premiere magazines. And here's from some time ago where. Megan Follows was just a wee nip.
A wee nip? What's it say?
And she was profiled in the cameo section of Premiere magazine. Do you remember doing this?
Oh, I do.
Oh,
wow.
My.
Wow. That's awesome.
You're so hot now, but that is hot.
So this
she's
from
really
the,
hot. Really she's super cute. Super
that
cute.
Is
sure
thank
she's you. Very 14-year-old. How old are you?
Well, you're 17? Killing me, Paul.
What?
She's not 14.
Yeah, she looks older in that picture.
I would have probably been closer to 17. 27?
No, still not legal.
Down, Bart. But it's profiling you in a stacking. Is that a movie?
Stacking. Yeah.
Yeah. Talks about your Bell Canadian commercial and a lot of things we covered here. Silver Bullet, Anne of Green Gables. Wow. But you do say something interesting in here.
No,
I just like this. A good role to me is a good role. When young people are portrayed realistically, they're just as fascinating as older people. So you can find all their colors. And so many screenplays that I read, it's rare that female characters are more than just somebody's girlfriend or the girl that comes in to get somebody laid. And then something like stacking comes along where the character is younger, but it's like, wow, I can really do something here. I like the idea that, did you struggle with this at all when you were a child actor? Because many child actors, Bart and I talked about this on the show, when you're a kid playing a kid, it's bad. When you're a kid being a kid, that's good, yeah. Right? Like, we can tell right away if you're putting on kid.
Right.
Did you develop that on your own? Did you get a lot of great direction? How did you so successfully have a child actor career?
I think I was really lucky that I had it in Canada, in a way, because, again, it wasn't like the trappings were going to be so huge to lure you into a... there's a lot of people, in fact, that I worked with. There's some, not a lot, but, you know, Corey Haim was one. So we were talking about The Silver Bullet, mm-hmm. and he didn't... he's obviously not with us today.
Haim.
Corey Haim. And it's... I just felt really lucky to have great roles. And, I mean, another one that I had done was... And it was a short film that won an Oscar in the 80s. It was called Boys and Girls, based on an Alice Munro short story about a young girl who sort of works on a fox farm with her dad and wants to be seen as a person, not just as a girl as she's growing older. So I was exposed to roles... like Anne, where there you were like the lead character. As I said, you were driving the action forward. You were Kathy. You were wanting to be on the team doing something, and it kind of gave me this taste for wanting to be the primary character or the way we all want to be. And so I don't know if that really answers your question about kids being kids, but I think that it is part of that.
I guess the roles, you say, kind of dictate.
Well, you weren't asked to be a kid. You were just asked to be, you weren't asked to act like a child. You were asked to be a kid with a role.
Yeah.
So you weren't, shucks, gee willikers and zany and goofy. I'm a kid,
yeah,
and
you
messy.
Weren't doing Dennis the Menace or something.
I hate that crap.
No, I was, and Anne was tricky because Anne was, it was definitely a very iconoclastic character. There was a lot of people who had a very strong idea of who they thought she was. And I had not read the book before I got the role. I had not seen that there was a musical that existed, and I read the book, had a reaction to who I thought she was, this character, had my own feelings about it, and expressed that. So I was there was an ownership, I think, that happened.
How did you avoid a lot of the young actor trappings? You know, you hear the stories about actors who go off the deep end or into dark places after a childhood actor career.
How did you beat drugs and alcohol?
I got knocked up and I got married. So I had children really
That'll
young.
Slow you down. Right there.
But then again, true.
But then again, you also had to go from being a young actress into a teen actor, into a young adult actor, yeah, into an adult woman. That's a lot of transitions.
It is a lot of transitions. I did have my children. I did have my when I was 23, I'd had my daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd already been working since I was 9, so it seemed like a long time. But my daughter, who's a little bit older than that now, I just think, no. Not for you, Missy. You know, how I also went and worked in the theater. I wanted to be able to play certain roles. I played Juliet. Actually, when my daughter was just born, I went to Stratford, our Shakespearean Theatre Festival, and I wanted to say that I had done that and could do that. So I think that the theater, and you guys are obviously in comedy, and if you were doing a lot of stuff with Second City, I think there's an incredible discipline that's required, and it's also not going to be about the money.
No.
And it's not always going to be, it's not going to be about celebrity. All of which, I love the money and I love the celebrity.
That that's the transition.
But that's okay.
But but you end up having gratitude for that.
Right, when you've worked.
Because you've worked and you haven't had it. Or mm-hmm. you've worked really hard and done things that you feel really proud of that maybe very few people have seen. Mm-hmm. Or maybe you've really tried something and you didn't succeed at it and you failed, but you had that's what you get to do in the theater as well.
Yep.
So you get to grow.
But that's the living in the moment thing that Karen was talking about with Bill Murray. It's like, you're not making money half the time at theater, but man, is it just fulfilling when you're doing it. Yeah. It's just your life has meaning for you.
Yeah, you feel like you're participating in your life. Everything's on the line. But I am one of these crazy actors who loves when something goes wrong on stage. Yeah. Because then I just feel like that's what I'm good at.
That's electric.
Too. Yeah, you just come alive and you just...
snap out of it. Yeah.
You can't say anything to the other person. You just look at him. You're like, I got this. I can make this work.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so exciting. The audience has no idea. But you're just like, oh, yeah. I love that. But I don't want things to go wrong. But when it does, I'm okay.
Absolutely.
Because it's
exciting.
Did
you get into a method as you grew older?
I didn't. I did study. I did some classes with Sandy Marshall, who did Meisner.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because I think you do. Where, with my
That's
brother-in-law.
That's how Kevin. Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Sean O'Brien.
Oh, the great Sean O'Brien who's here a few weeks ago.
The great Sean O'Brien, who is a very, very talented, very funny actor, man. Mm-hmm. That my brother-in-law has me always in stitches. So I think classes are really important. I don't prescribe to a singular method. I don't. That's just not what works for me. I like... kind of I love characters. I want to kind of know them and breathe them and be them, and but there's also a real technical side too, especially in when we're in from film and television. It's a different world. You have to have a technical understanding, and television, you don't always have the luxury. You don't have the luxury of time.
Yeah.
So you have to know how to get somewhere fairly quickly, get in, own that role and take it on, because so I envy actors that when I hear that they had months to become so and so and they were living that and they only spoke in that accent the whole
right
time.
I
think that's amazing. I've never had the
you don't go full Daniel Day-Lewis.
I've never had the luxury of that.
We put up plays in about 2.5 weeks, and that seems like a luxury.
Yeah.
Now, you said you played Juliet. Is there a stage role now that you're interested in?
Well, there's many that I'm interested in. It's funny. I just went and saw at the Broad stage in here in Santa Monica, the Beckett. It's a trilogy of Beckett that's playing there. Not I. It's come from an actress from Ireland. It was really... quite an amazing piece of theater to see.
Well, that's good. Because I just went to Chicago and went to Chicago Shakespeare Theater out on Navy Pier and saw this guy from the Royal Shakespeare Company do this one-man show that he wrote about a guy he saw in a Thomas Gainsborough painting, and he made this whole show.
Wow.
And I was sitting there going, is anybody from California? You need to see this guy's acting.
It's amazing.
He's acting.
Yeah.
People who are just winging it out in L.A. Yeah. These guys, so they're really... delivering it down there in Santa Monica?
Yeah, no, it was fantastic. I used to see a lot of fantastic theater in L.A., also through UCLA Live.
Yes.
I'd see different productions that would come in from all over the world. I loved seeing the Mark Rylands, his all-male Shakespeares. And that was funny. As a woman, like seeing an all-male Shakespeare now, I was like, really? and they rocked it. He was the best Olivia I've ever seen.
Originally how it was done, right?
Mark Rylands. Yeah. Oscar winner, Mark Rylands.
Yeah, right. So it was... So there's a lot. I just was in London and I saw a Chekhov, and I do, I have to say, listening to Chekhov, I was like, oh God, those words are pretty. You know, everybody's having some crisis. You know, they're really, they're on the estate, and really life is, well, we know life isn't, give it another 10 years and life's about to take a huge turn.
Yeah.
But it's just those sort of incredible, it's just having words to live in and express things.
Have you been on Broadway?
I have not been on Broadway. Oh. No, I've done most of my theater work in Canada.
And you did the Stratford Festival?
Yes.
Yeah. See, we used to go up there as a school trip and check stuff out.
Right.
Oh, the one in Ontario.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very cool.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you what we ask every.
Oh yeah, this is fun. Oh, here we go.
What is your favorite movie of all time?
I don't have a favorite movie of all time. I really
fine. Let me narrow it down for you.
favorite Tom Cruise movie.
Oh,
don't
no.
listen to him.
I'm not going to. No. One of the movies that I actually have really loved is actually the poster is on your wall. It was one that came to me when I knew you were going to ask me this question.
She loves Safe House.
Pets?
No.
Is it The Razor's Edge? Bridesmaids?
Bridesmaids?
Yeah,
Bridesmaids. There you go.
Cool.
Yeah, it's off camera here.
I'm going to tell. Actually, I love Bridesmaids.
It's so funny.
I just thought it was effing hysterical.
Yeah.
I
mean,
I
had to be, right.
I loved that. But I was thinking about that. There's like movies that really impacted me at different times.
Mm-hmm.
When I saw Toy Story 3,
mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness.
My daughter was about to go off to college.
Oh.
And I was like going, as all those Toy Story movies were happening, my kids were the same age. My daughter was the same age as that. And so I wept.
Yeah, you did.
No, I wept through Toy Story 3. And the moment when they're all heading towards the incinerator.
Yeah.
And instead of this big panic screaming moment, they just hold each other's hands like, well, if we're going to go, we'll go together. You know, I was like,
oh,
you know, with my daughter and her teenage friends, like, what the? Mom is, I'm going to talk.
If you're crying
that.
There, then yeah, afterwards, the last 10 minutes of that
no,
movie,
yeah,
it's just everybody's
so,
a mess.
That's a great movie.
Yeah, I love that. And then, but then when I was thinking, when I was films like Death in Venice was a film that came.
Oh, what is that?
I don't know.
Visconti's with Dirk Bogart.
You've
no.
This is where we're said, really missing out.
This is amazing because okay. This is a movie Paul doesn't know. That's crazy.
Yeah,
it was one that I remember just making a big impact on me. And then you asked me a part that I love, and so it's a film that I love, is Streetcar. With Brando and Vivian.
Yeah. So we're talking Brando version.
Yeah. I saw that mm-hmm. in Chicago with Gary Sinise.
Yep.
And you know, people would say, he's too short. Not if he acts the hell out of it. He's
yeah,
not.
He was fine.
And I mean, that's an incredible play.
Killing everyone on that stage was John C. Reilly as Mitch. Anyway,
yep.
That was, it was a great production.
That was amazing.
Yeah. Oh, man. And what a great movie. And you know, Brando, way ahead of his time in that. And
well,
on
but Vivian Leigh is brilliant in that movie, too. She is brilliant. And the chemistry between those two actors, and they are two different schools,
mm-hmm.
and they come together, and that's what I think is so fascinating too. When you asked about styles and mm-hmm. what do you do, and she'd been doing that play in London that Laurence Olivier had been directing her in at that time, and he was obviously Brando was doing it in New York with Jessica Tandy, and they put those two together, and I don't think they got along.
Perfect.
You'd hear stories about that with him and Anna Magnani, and the other one I love, which is The Fugitive Kind.
Feel free to give us as many details about the fight they had.
I don't know. You just hear, but you just watch it.
What do you hear? Yes, what do you hear?
Well, you just look at the chemistry on film. And again, but the structure of that piece, and then of course, incredible direction and language, just these words that these characters get to speak, this poetry.
Mm-hmm.
You were talking about Bill Murray and poetry, and I mean, it's pretty magical when you actually get to do a scene, and it's obviously not really naturalism because they're all of a sudden they're speaking this, but it's something that just absolutely, exquisitely says what you're feeling or what you are afraid to feel. Or wow, this got really shit. Wow. Okay, it is a garage, and it is late at night. You did ask me, and I did warn you that I didn't have one.
Well, you had three, and then one we haven't heard of.
Yeah, one we haven't heard of. That's really impressive.
What was it? Venice? Murder in Venice?
No, Death in Venice.
Death in Venice.
You have to write that down. All right, Karen, listen. Let's
take
things out the way you always do with Karen's birthdays.
I'm going to Google the picture while
you're at the birthdays of those who make the movies. Take it away, Karen.
All right. So first, we're going to start by wishing a very happy birthday to friend of the show, Brendan Beiser, who turns 46 but can play anywhere from a Canadian to an American. And Paul and I first worked with our friend Brendan back when we did a Renaissance fair. He played a sailor named Kent Swim.
Kent Swim.
Kent Swim. It was
funny.
The greatest thing.
Did we mention it's a Ren
fair? He was fantastic. But here's what's kind of cool. He worked in, he was known for playing Agent Pendrell in The X-Files. But I don't think you worked with him, though, because he was up in Vancouver filming, and he was always in the FBI whenever Scully would come in.
I died giving birth to the alien baby, so I didn't make it past the trailer. Or the it was gone before the credits.
Oh, no, you know what? That was my favorite part, because Paul and I would tune in, and we'd watch, and then death during the alien baby thing, and then we'd be like, oh my gosh, how can you possibly turn it off now?
Well, especially because I didn't know that I was having an alien baby. So I start thinking I'm just having a baby. And then it like comes out and it's put on my lap and it's like,
that's fantastic.
And then they just inject me with some serum because they'd known that I know too much.
Oh, so then they put you out.
They killed me.
Jeez.
She might talk, you know. She just had an alien baby.
I don't recommend it.
No. But our friend Brendan also did Excess Baggage with Alicia Silverstone and Benicio del Toro and The Tooth Fairy. Quite an illustrious career.
Is that Diesel or The Rock?
The Rock.
Okay.
That's The Rock, yeah.
What am I thinking of? Nanny?
The Pacifier.
Pacifier.
And also he was in Reservoir Dogs.
What a horrible name for a title.
The Tooth Fairy?
The Pacifier.
Oh, The Pacifier. Yeah.
That movie literally sucks.
Oh. Also, this is just kind of a crazy thing, but Brendan appeared in an episode of Rain. He played Edmund on an episode called Abandoned. I don't expect you to remember working with him, but how
did
crazy
I kill
is
him?
That?
Did I?
Let's hope so.
Did I put him in a dungeon? Did I?
You probably.
Let's say yes.
Let's just say you probably killed him. I didn't realize that when we were doing all this. I just wanted to say happy birthday to him, and I saw I worked on an episode of Rain, which I thought was exciting. And then let's wish a very happy birthday to Giancarlo Esposito, who turns 58. And he is going to be opening the, what is that thing? The Jungle Book this week. He's playing the wolf. So he can play anywhere from a wolf to a Usual Suspect. You'll know him from the Usual Suspects.
I was going to say, I recognize that name from earlier previews of the show.
Yes, that's right. His voice appears right alongside Bill Murray's voice. And also, you may have heard his voice in the opening credits of The Electric Company when he was just a little kid. When he was 7, he sang the theme song.
Electric Company.
How fun is that?
And they get that up in Canada?
The Electric Company.
Yeah, of course.
I
used to watch it on the channel, the Canadian Channel 5. I would watch Electric Company and Mr. Rogers because it would come down.
Rogers, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone else remember Zoom?
Oh, was that a Canadian?
Come on and Zoom,
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 Zoom.
Was that a Canadian show?
Come on and Zoom, Zoom, Zoom.
I think so.
Zoom and Wonderland.
All I remember is that song, them sitting on a sign that says Zoom, and then red and yellow socks.
Yeah, Zoom.
Oh, that's fun. That's good times. Also, I just wanted to bring up the fact that he was singing in The Electric Company, but then you'll also know him as Gus in Breaking Bad.
Hell yeah.
Oh, wow.
He was amazing in that.
And going way back before that,
yes,
Do the Right Thing.
Do the Right Thing.
Why don't you get some brothers up on the wall here? Malcolm X, Michael Jordan, today.
At 8 years old, he appeared in his first Broadway musical, Maggie Flynn. His mother was an opera singer, and she was pregnant with him while she was splitting the bill with Josephine Baker in France.
Whoa.
Isn't that amazing?
Wow.
Yeah. So the guy can sing. He's absolutely gorgeous. He can play anywhere from like a sweetheart to like a killer.
Yeah.
I loved him in Breaking Bad. So happy birthday.
Need to watch
Mo Better
Blues because he's smooth in that too.
I would definitely
like
that.
Denzel and Wesley, they're all playing jazz. I mean, come on.
Right.
In the
Mo Better is Mo Better.
Yeah, it's
a greatest. And lastly, let's wish a happy birthday to Christopher Walken, who turned 73, by the way. How does that happen?
I don't know.
That's amazing. Without paying attention. He could play anywhere from a deer hunter to a song and dance man to a psychologically unstable killer. He got an Oscar win for Best Supporting Actor in The Deer Hunter, as you guys all know. And
wait a minute, that psychologically unstable killer, that's his walking around guy?
Yeah, that's just him at the Albertsons.
That's just him.
So don't point at him and say his name. But he was George Lucas' second choice for the role of Han Solo in the New Hope. Isn't that an interesting way to play Han Solo?
Wait,
think
in the New Hope? Oh, in New Hope.
1977.
Oh my God,
Star
that would have been horrible.
It would have been interesting. So that brings up my interesting
thing.
Millennium
Falcon.
Yes.
It's the fastest ship in the galaxy.
I was just going to say,
how
Paul,
fast it goes.
Can you give us a little Han Solo as Christopher Walken?
That's what I got, yeah.
How about when he talks to Princess Leia? What's that thing?
I don't know. I can imagine quite a lot. And I don't even claim to do walking.
I
but
know.
Everyone does them anyway.
But
you do Jack, you do walking, even though you don't do it.
So, Bart, here's a couple. You can either pick a Christopher Walken movie quote or just a personal quote.
What am I supposed to do here?
Try your best Christopher Walken.
Oh, I do not have a walk.
I don't have one either.
I'm neglecting my other guests. Enjoy yourself. You'll find the young ladies stimulating company. I had it at the beginning, then I lost it at the end.
That's good.
Hey, at the end, you kind of sounded like Kermit the Frog.
Are you gonna make now? Megan has to do it.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Oh, no, wow.
Yeah, go ahead.
There's a funny one on the.
Well, why
ones.
Am I the one that's supposed to be doing
this?
Paul's good.
This is a good
my
one.
Hair was famous before I was.
And then Megan, try
The one. Scooching.
Wait, what are these quotes from movies? Or
from
just
him in life.
Oh, gotcha.
The last one's funny.
Bear costumes are funny. Bears as well.
That was awesome!
You did a better one than I did.
Awesome. Paul, would you like to try one?
What do we got?
Now, we have some stuff in the Deer Hunter, but the ones in the bottom are just him spouting.
You're talking to me all wrong. It's the wrong tone. Do it again, I'll stab you in the face. The soldering iron. Hey, tell me, does your mother sew? Boom, get her to sew that. Is he Italian?
What
is
he kind of
put a little Italian on.
Okay, so they were talking about why he speaks with this kind of broken thing. He said he grew up around immigrants, and he grew up learning English from people who didn't speak English as their first language. So whenever he takes these unusual pauses, it's because that's just how he learned to speak.
Work for him.
Mm-hmm. Because usually when people take those odd pauses, it's because they're trying to think of what the word is.
Mm. More screen time.
More screen time.
Brilliant.
That's brilliant. Now, Bart, you know how much I love when celebrities sing.
This is true, Megan. I don't know about you, but this happens to me almost every day. People stop me on the street, and they say, tell me two interesting things about that Karen Volpe. Happens. And the first thing I tell them is that hair in her head is hers. It doesn't come from her nose.
Good to know.
Secondly,
yes.
I tell them she loves when celebrities sing.
I do, and I couldn't find you singing anywhere. Otherwise,
that's probably good.
You would have been being thrown under the bus. But instead, Christopher Walken, he sings all the time, clearly. And this is actually a pretty great little clip here, singing a little You Can't Take That Away From Me for a PBS special for Gershwin.
The way your smile just be.
Notice he has those weird pauses still, though.
The way you sing off key.
He's got dulcet tones.
The way you haunt my
He's
dreams.
Got a velvet fog.
I like it.
No, no, they can't take that away from me.
So happy birthday,
no,
all you guys.
They can't take that
nice.
Away from me.
Christopher Walken. Nice.
Brendan, and of course, Esposito there.
Giancarlo Esposito. All right.
That's
well, thank you,
cool.
Karen. That wraps the movie Showcast. Together, we are the movie guys. Individually, we are.
Karen Volpe.
Follow us on Twitter at the movie guys, on Facebook.com/the movie guys, iTunes, Instagram, LinkedIn, even whatever. We're there. Thank you to all of our new listeners on WRFA 107.9 in Jamestown, New York. Please come back every Monday night at 8. And thanks to Megan Follow. So, what are we plugging? 25th of April. Rain is back.
Rain is back.
Catch everything up to now on Hulu.
Absolutely.
And you say you're getting slowly into social media, or is there a place we should go?
I've got Meg Follows. I'm on Twitter, and I'm on Instagram. So
I'll make sure I go follow you.
Meg_Follows.
I'm going to follow Meg underscore follows.
And we'll thanks to Steve Scholes for his writing contributions to the show every week. And as ever, we owe everything
to Pat Peach.
And remember, you can always find everything we're up to at themovieguys.net. Next week, we're off. So you'll have to find out about
we're
the
We're off. We're going to go meet Bill Murray. It's very exciting.
The Huntsman Winter's War that's coming out. You'll have to learn that from somebody else. But you know what? You can probably guess what's going on in the movie. But tune in to where you normally find our show, as we'll be posting a best of jokes and bits compilation from 2015. So we will see you in 2 weeks.
Woohoo!
Thanks again, Megan.
Yay!
Best rehearsal ever, Megan.
Woo!